With that, then, the state may call its next witness.
The state calls Deputy Steve Kivi.
Mr. Kivi, can you step over here real quick? I'll swear you. Do you swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
Yes.
Okay. Go ahead and seat over there if you would.
Thank you, Your Honor. Would you state and spell your name, please?
Steve Kivi, K-I-V as in Victor I.
And who is your employer?
Poweshiek County Sheriff's Office.
And what do you do for the Sheriff's Office?
I'm a deputy sheriff currently assigned to investigations.
How long have you held that position?
I've been with Poweshiek County for over 16 years, and I've been assigned as an investigator for over 8.
And do you have other law enforcement experience?
Yes, I was a police officer in Iowa City for 8 years.
And can you describe your training and experience as it pertains to law enforcement?
I graduated in 1996 from Indian Hills Community College with an associate degree in criminal justice and a bachelor's degree in political science. January of 1997, I was hired by the Iowa City Police Department. Began the academy a few days later, graduated in April, went through the field training process, completed that successfully, and for the next 7.5 years worked in the patrol division.
Are you a certified peace officer in the state of Iowa?
Yes.
And Deputy Kivi, on July 19th, 2018, did you receive a call about a missing person?
Yes.
Can you describe that call, please?
Sheriff Kriegel called me at home. It was about 9:30 p.m. and told me that a 20-year-old female from Brooklyn named Mollie Tibbetts had been missing, and that Deputy Matt Simpson had been following up on that and investigating for the last few hours.
And what did you do in response to that call?
I went down to the sheriff's office and with intentions of trying to locate the phone or do something, but after talking to Deputy Simpson, that had already been done unsuccessfully. I was told that a search effort had been organized for first thing in the morning, and that I was supposed to start working on this the very next morning.
When you talk about the phone, what exactly are you referring to?
I thought we could ping the phone, try to locate the phone in an effort to find Mollie.
And whose phone were you?
Mollie Tibbetts.
Do you know where Mollie Tibbetts was staying on the evening of July 18th?
Yes, she was staying at 622 West Des Moines Street in Brooklyn.
And whose residence was that?
That's the residence of Blake and Allie Jack. And Dalton Jack, Mollie's boyfriend, would stay there at that residence also when he was in town, when he wasn't on the road working.
Did you go to that residence at any point in time?
Yes. The next day, which would have been July 20th, the first thing I did is went to the sheriff's office and tried to start organizing this investigation, gathering as much information. I knew that search efforts were being organized in Brooklyn, so I was at the sheriff's office for, I don't know, a short time. And then maybe around 9:30 or 10 in the morning, I went to 622 West Des Moines, where I met DCI agent Trent Valletta.
And you're the investigator for the Poweshiek County Sheriff's Office?
Yes.
And so would you be the person responsible for heading this search when it initially began?
Somewhat. The Friday kind of turned into, we had search effort, and then we had kind of an investigation angle to it too. I was more involved in like interviewing like Blake and Allie and Trent Valletta, and I walked through the home. I did end up searching though.
Did you find anything of interest during that search?
Not that morning, no.
And during the search of the home, was there any indication found as to where Mollie may have gone?
Well, Deputy Simpson had relayed to me that that Thursday night, the 19th, he had gone through the home at 622 West Des Moines, and he had also talked to Mollie's mother Laura, and he had gone to their house at 114 Bear Drive in Brooklyn, and they noticed that her running shoes were gone, and that Blake had also told Matt Simpson that the dogs were in the basement. So those two things together indicated that she had probably gone for a run.
And did you learn during the course of your investigation Mollie's routine concerning her runs?
Yes.
And what did you learn?
We learned that she liked to jog at night or in the evening, late afternoon, and that her routes would vary, but that one of her routes would be 385th Avenue that runs east out of Brooklyn.
And Deputy Kivi, were there any other agencies involved in the investigation or search for Mollie Tibbetts?
Yes. The very first day, the July 20th, we had several law enforcement agencies, our agency, we had assistance from Jasper County, State Patrol, DCI, I'm probably missing somebody, but we also had numerous volunteer firefighters, community members who were out searching road ditches, rural areas, fields.
Deputy Kivi, can you tell me what a canvas is?
Yeah, canvas is a, I guess it'd be an investigative technique that we employed during this time, where we went door to door, and I believe every residence in Brooklyn, trying to ascertain who lives there, who might have been visiting at the time that we believe she disappeared, any vehicles associated with the residence, and any video that they might have.
Is that something that was expanded beyond the city limits?
Yes. That technique was law enforcement related. We had other people searching fields and volunteers searching fields, but we also went door to door to farm residences, rural residences, and we focused our search effort in the rural areas. I would say basically in the I would say generally the southeastern quarter of our county.
Can you tell me approximately how long that process lasted?
At least a month.
Did you discover any evidence indicating where Mollie may have gone during the course of your canvas?
We had some initial information regarding her cell phone that led us to focus our efforts in that area.
Deputy, what was the significance to the search on the southeast part of the county?
We had information from an FBI analyst who did some research on her cell phone that led us to believe that the last location of her cell phone was in that area.
Of Mollie Tibbetts' cell
yes.
phone? During the course of the investigation, was any surveillance video obtained?
Yes.
And from what sources was that obtained?
We had video from numerous sources. The one that was useful to us came from 616 West Des Moines Street, a residence in Brooklyn.
Whose residence was that?
Logan Collins.
What was significant about that video?
We had a team of law enforcement officers reviewing video from all kinds of places. In that particular video, the officers reviewing that picked up on a black Chevy Malibu that was seen in that area. And I'll back up a little bit. 616 East Des Moines Street. It's kind of on the eastern side of Brooklyn. And we believe that Mollie Tibbetts have been jogging in that area. And through their review of that video, they were able to ascertain that particular vehicle would have had to have been in the area when Mollie Tibbetts was jogging through, and most likely would have seen her. He was just kind of driving around. And
were you aware of Christina Stewart's report of seeing Mollie?
Yes.
And is that how you knew the general location of Mollie's run?
Yes.
And I want to clarify one thing, Deputy Kivi. On Logan Collins' residence, was that on East Des Moines Street?
Yes. Did I say west?
You
Sorry.
Did.
Yeah, east.
Did you actually view that video from Collins' residence?
Some of it. I didn't review the whole thing. I saw the pertinent clips, but I didn't see the whole thing.
And what were the pertinent clips?
Of the vehicle traveling around that area, circling around, just kind of lingering in the area for a while.
You saw the vehicle on the video?
Yes.
Can you describe the vehicle for me, please?
It was a black Chevy Malibu. Initially, when that information was passed on from the officers reviewing the video, it was described as a black Chevy Malibu, model year 2008 to 2012, with chrome mirror covers and chrome door handles. So that's kind of what we were looking for. I remember seeing the clips. I don't think it was until the next day or later that I saw the clips, but that's the kind of vehicle that I was looking for.
Do you recall the date that the vehicle, the Chevy Malibu, was identified as a vehicle of interest?
Yes.
When was that date?
August 16th. Or I'm sorry, it was identified on video August 15th.
And when did you learn about the vehicle?
That day.
I want to direct your attention to the following day, August 16th, 2018. And on that date, did you encounter a black Chevy Malibu?
Yes.
Can you describe that encounter for me?
yeah, I was driving north on Highway 63 in my county vehicle. It was a dark blue Dodge Durango. I was driving north on Highway 63, and I was going underneath the Interstate 80 overpass. And as I went under the overpass, I saw a black Chevy Malibu with chrome mirror covers at the stop sign at the westbound off ramp. And it caught my eye, and I drove past it, and then I pulled over on the shoulder to see where it was going to go because I wanted to identify that vehicle and driver.
And had you been looking for black Chevy Malibus at that point?
Yes.
Did you follow the vehicle?
I did. The vehicle turned north onto Highway 63, so it would have driven past me, and I caught the license plate as it did. I ran it through our dispatch center, and I began to follow the Malibu north on Highway 63. I learned that the vehicle was registered to a female from Tama, and as we drove into Malcolm, which is less than a mile from Interstate 80, the vehicle turned west onto 2nd Street, and so I followed it, and then it turned north into an alley, and I lost sight of it for a second, but as I turned north into the alley, I saw that it was parked. So I parked in the alley, I got out, and the driver was already out of the vehicle. So I said, hey, can I talk to you for a second? And he turned around, and I tried to communicate with him. It became pretty obvious quickly that he didn't speak English. But there happened to be some older gentleman in a yard nearby that walked over and said he could help us communicate.
And Deputy Kivi, you said you ran the plate of that vehicle. Is that right?
Yes.
Do you recall what that license plate number was?
Yes, it was D. David K. King P. Paul 055.
And the registered owner of that vehicle, was that Arlie Lorenzana?
Yes.
Were you able to identify the driver of the Malibu?
Yes. I asked him if he had any identification. He showed me a document as a birth certificate that gave his name as Cristhian Mejia Rivera and his birth date. I asked him, is this you? And he said yes.
And do you see the driver of that vehicle in the courtroom today?
Yes.
Where is he sitting?
Is at the defendant table with looks like a light blue button-down collared shirt and the headphones on.
Were you able to find any other information, about the defendant when you spoke with him that day?
Yes. I asked him where he worked. He told me he worked at Yerba Farms and had for about the past 4 years. He gave me a cell phone number. I asked him how often he goes into Brooklyn. He goes in occasionally. He said he has some friends in town that he goes to visit sometimes. He gave me his what would be his common route from his residence to town. And when I first asked him what his address was, he said it was, I believe, it was 1840 400th Avenue, which would be Yerba Farms where he works. Later we would learn that he lived on a property owned by Yerba Farms, but it was on 200th, I think 21, 41 something, 200th. So when he tried to describe to me, he said, I take the gravel to the pavement. So when I was imagining him leaving Yerba Farms, I thought, well, he must take like 190th to Old Six as a pavement and into Brooklyn. But later, when we realized that he actually lived at a different location, on 200th, it made more sense to me when he said, I take the gravel to the pavement, that he would take 200th Street north to 385th and go into town on 385th, which is paved all the way from Brooklyn to 200th.
Deputy Kivi,
if that makes sense.
And 385th was the road that Mollie was last seen on, is that right?
Yes.
What is Yerba Farms?
It's a dairy farm just outside of Brooklyn, a few miles.
Are you familiar with its location?
Yes.
Deputy Kivi, I'd like to show you Exhibit 2. It should pop up on the screen in front of you in a moment. Are you familiar with this map?
Yes.
And what is it?
That's
this?
A map of Poweshiek County.
And could you describe where Yerba Farms is located on this map?
Roughly, let's see. Yerba Farms would be located right about where that arrow is, actually. Roughly.
That arrow is an accurate depiction of where Yerba Farms is? Did you take photographs during your encounter with the driver?
Yes.
And what photographs did you take?
I took one of Mr. Rivera, and I took a few of his car.
I'd like to direct your attention to Exhibit 22. Are you familiar with this image?
Yes, I took that picture.
And what's depicted?
That's the vehicle that I encountered in Malcolm.
The vehicle that caught your attention?
Yes.
Driven by Mr. Cristhian Mejia Rivera?
Yes.
This is the picture. When did you take that picture?
August 16th.
Where was the picture taken?
In Malcolm. I believe it was to the rear of 205 Clay Street in Malcolm, in an alley behind the residence.
I'd like to move to Exhibit 23. What is this picture?
It's a picture of Mr. Rivera.
Did you take that picture?
Yes.
When did you take it?
That day, August 16th.
And where was it taken?
Same location.
Same time?
Yes.
Deputy, I've got a couple more exhibits for you. I'd like to move to 38 and 39. Are you familiar with this image?
Yes.
What is it?
That's a picture of the same car, and that's in our Sallyport at the sheriff's office in the garage area.
And does this photograph capture the license plate of that vehicle?
Yes.
Is it the same license plate number that you encountered on August 16th, 2018?
Yes.
I'd like to move to 40 and 41. What is depicted in these images?
The same car in our Sallyport garage area.
And are there any distinguishing features captured in this image?
I would say the chrome mirror covers and the chrome door handles and the license plate.
Is this the same car you encountered on August 16th, 2018?
Yes.
Then I'd like to move to Exhibit 42. And what is this, Deputy Kibbe?
It's a kind of a closer up picture of the same car. It appears to be focused on the chrome mirror.
Did you ask the defendant about Mollie Tibbetts when you encountered him on August 16th?
Yes.
And what was his response?
He said he had heard that there was a girl missing from Brooklyn, but didn't have any knowledge that would be useful to us.
Deputy Kivi, what were you wearing on August 16th, 2018 when you encountered the defendant?
I was wearing a black short sleeve polo with a gold Poweshiek County Sheriff Star sewn onto it, khaki pants with the sidearm and my badge affixed to my belt, and black boots.
Was it apparent that you were a law enforcement officer by your dress?
I would assume so.
Did you identify yourself to the defendant as a law enforcement officer?
I did. I said my name is Steve Kivian with the Poweshiek County Sheriff's Office.
Did you make an arrest at that point?
No.
And how did you end the encounter with the defendant?
Probably just said thanks for your time, and he walked off and I got in my car.
Did you do anything subsequent to that encounter, report it to anyone, anything of that nature?
I did.
What did you do?
I made a phone call. I don't remember who it was to. Told him about the encounter. I don't remember if I sent the pictures that day. I remember showing pictures to people the next day.
Thank you, Deputy. We have no further questions for you at this time.
Defense may cross-examine.
Deputy Kibbe, I'll kind of work backwards. We'll start with the interaction with Mr. Bahena on the 16th, right?
Yes.
Of August. When you talked to him that day, describe his demeanor, please.
He seemed calm and not nervous. And
he was polite?
Yes.
He answered all your questions?
He did.
Produced all information you requested of him?
He did.
Did you get the opportunity to look about his car and see if you could find anything of evidentiary value?
I didn't actually search his car. I looked inside through the windows while he was in his glove box getting his document that he produced.
Did you notice anything unusual about the inside of his car?
No.
Okay. And he told you where he worked and he told you where he lived, correct?
Yes.
Up to that point, on August 16th, where he told you where he worked and told you where he lived, had you received any information concerning those locations being suspicious in the disappearance of Mollie Tibbetts?
As far as, I'm sorry, where he worked, you said?
Yes.
No.
Had you received any tips or any intelligence that Mollie Tibbetts may have been abducted by an individual named Cristhian Rivera?
No.
Had you received any tips or intelligence that the likely suspect was Hispanic?
No.
You were involved in this investigation every day, correct?
Yes.
Were there briefings every day?
Yes.
And were you involved in briefings with both the DCI and the FBI?
Yes.
And the FBI utilized vast resources, didn't they?
Yes.
That included agents from Washington, D.C., right?
Yes.
And some of these agents were agents from the Behavioral Analysis Unit, right?
I'm not sure about that.
Okay. Did any of these briefings that you were involved in include briefings from the FBI as to what kind of individual you're likely looking for?
I don't believe so, no.
Okay. The southeast corner of the county, define that for me.
Very rural.
Very rural?
Very rural, yeah.
Okay, but what would be the draw me a mental picture. Where's the top end, where's the bottom end, and the east and west corners?
We can pull that map up, I could show you. Or you just want me to describe it to you?
Just describe it to me.
Poweshiek County is very rural. Interstate 80 goes east and west right through the middle of the county. Brooklyn is right along Interstate 80, maybe just to the east of center. So I would say, I mean, it's if you go straight south of Brooklyn, if you can imagine southeastern quadrant, Interstate 80 runs right through there. Highway 21 runs straight south from Interstate 80. I would say right straight through that quadrant, basically. There's a couple little towns down there, Deep River and Guernsey. I guess, does that answer your question?
So you're looking in the Deep River, Guernsey area?
Yeah, in that area, in that kind of cone shape, I guess.
Is that the area where Mollie was ultimately found?
Yes.
And the reason that area was focused on was because that was where her cell phone last pinged, right?
That was where, I don't know, a technical term, that's where we were told that the phone powered off, or that was the last known location of the phone.
Okay. And that's what led you to an individual named Wayne Cheney?
Yes.
Because his home was near there.
Yes.
And Mr. Cheney, did you canvass or search his area?
Yes.
And what was the connection or the attraction to Mr. Cheney as someone of interest?
Basically, Wayne Cheney lived in the area, or does as far as I know still. He'd had a kind of history of no contact order violations, just kind of a reputation as being a little different around women, I guess, to put it. All we knew in those first days were that was where her phone was. We didn't have anything solid leading to anybody. We were...
Did you or any other law enforcement, to your knowledge, have any tips regarding Wayne Cheney and his involvement in this investigation?
That's possible, but I couldn't tell you for sure.
Would you agree with me that if there were a tip involving someone who had a history of violence against women, or perhaps being sexually deviant,
mm-hmm.
In that quadrant of the county, that'd mm-hmm. be something law enforcement would want to follow up on?
Yes.
And tell me why that is.
Well, we had a missing 20-year-old under suspicious circumstances. Unlike her, we also learned through that FBI phone analysis that she was jogging and witness test or eyewitness accounts that she had been jogging on 385th Avenue. She had her phone with her. There was some kind of what they called event at a certain point along 385th Avenue, and all of a sudden her phone is traveling like 55 or 60 miles an hour south down a gravel road, and then it just shuts off in the middle of nowhere.
Wayne Cheney lived on 470th Avenue, correct?
Yes.
And Molly's body was found on 460th Avenue, correct?
Yes.
So basically Wayne Cheney lived about a mile south of where Molly's body was found, and perhaps I think a little bit to the west, right?
Yes, that's right.
Now, were you involved in any canvassing of 460th Avenue?
Yes.
Did you talk to the residents up and down 460th Avenue?
Yes.
Did you talk to anybody who resided in the 2400 block of 460th Avenue?
I don't believe I did. Somebody probably did, but I don't recall going that far personally.
Would it be important in your training, education, and experience to talk to the people who lived immediately in the area where Molly's body was found?
Yes.
And why is that?
I'm sorry?
Why is that?
Well, we would want to know if they saw anything or had any information that would be useful, saw anything suspicious around that time.
Do you know whose property Molly's body was found on?
I believe the last name is Bear.
Okay. Do you know who owns the property immediately adjacent to the west of Molly's body?
I don't.
If I gave you the name Ron Pexa, would that jog your memory?
Immediately to the west?
Correct.
Yes. I did go there. I remember talking to him.
You did talk to Ron Pexa?
Yes.
And why did you talk to Mr. Pexa?
I believe we had some information come in about him. I don't recall specifically what it was. I went there with a couple of other agents and we talked to him for, I don't know, a half hour.
Was that recorded?
Not that I know of.
Was a report made of that?
Not by me.
Did Mr. Pexa tell you he was a law enforcement officer?
Yes. Or retired or part-time or I don't remember.
And the information you received about Mr. Pexa, please tell me what it was.
I don't remember where it came from. I don't remember.
Did the report involve him being sexually violent in the past?
It could have. I don't really remember.
Was this before or after Molly was found dead?
That was before.
Okay. And he lived approximately less than a quarter mile from where her body was found?
I'm not sure about the distance, but nearby.
If his address is 2410 460th Avenue?
That sounds about right.
That's about where her body would have been found.
Yeah, that could be accurate, yeah.
And if Mr. Pexa, I'm assuming that if he had a history of violence against women, that's something you would have followed up on?
Yes.
You recall who the agents were you went there with?
I think it was Agent Valletta from the DCI, and I think Agent Patras from the FBI.
Okay. And you'd agree with me that an investigation of this magnitude, that something as important as investigating and talking to someone who has the allegations against them like Mr. Pexa, those would be documented, wouldn't you think?
I would think. Yeah, I don't know. I didn't.
You weren't the investigating officer, so you necessarily wouldn't do it, right?
I didn't. No, I didn't. I don't think I had anything on Mr. Pexa.
Okay. But you had a lot on Mr. Cheney.
Not really. I mean, he was interviewed at least once that I know of, and I know he was looked at very closely.
Okay, he was interviewed
very closely. He was looked at,
right.
And eventually cleared.
Okay, he was interviewed at least twice, right?
I think so.
His property was searched, right?
I believe so.
And to your recollection, Ron Pexa, his property was, or wasn't searched, was it?
I believe we did.
And can you tell me what that property search entailed?
We were in his house. We walked through some outbuildings.
Was that quarter mile stretch between where Molly's body was ultimately found and Mr. Pex's house, was that searched by volunteers?
It could have been. I know we didn't do it that day.
Was Mr. Pex ever brought into the fire department and officially interviewed?
Not that I know of.
Okay. Do you know if he denied any type of sexual deviance or violence against women?
I don't remember him being asked that specifically, but it's possible.
Okay. In response to Mr. Claver's question, you seem to opine that where Mr. Bahena was living, he would have traveled north on 200 Street and then went in 385th to get to Brooklyn, right?
Right.
200 Street, if I understand it correctly, goes straight north, correct?
Yes.
And as you go straight north a couple miles, well, first of all, is it north or south of Interstate 80?
His residence?
Yes.
Just north.
Okay. You go north on 200 Street. He told you he gets to the blacktop and then turns, right?
Right. Correct.
Yeah, so you turn left, actually, to get to Brooklyn.
Correct.
So 385th is not the first blacktop you hit, right?
No.
So you hit Old Highway 6 first.
Right.
You take Highway 6 left, and that takes you into Brooklyn, too.
Yes, it could.
So he never clarified whether he took Old Highway 6 or kept going north to 385th and took the blacktop, right?
That's right.
So the idea that he shot across Old Highway 6, kept going north, and then took 385th in is mere speculation.
That was my opinion. But he didn't give me the correct address, his correct address when I asked him the first time either. I only learned of his actual address later.
Okay. And again, he spoke very little English.
Right, that's great.
And was he able to give you anything with his correct address on it?
Not that day I talked to him.
Okay. But he's able to give you the address of where he worked.
That's right.
Your testimony to the jury that he just left out the fact that there was a blacktop he would cross first, you just opine that he blew past the first blacktop, went to the second one, which just happens to be the one where Mollie Tibbetts was running, right?
Right. That's what I thought after we realized what his actual address was.
Okay. And that fits the narrative because that's where she was running the day she was.
Certainly a possibility.
Yeah. But there's no evidence that you can provide that's what he did.
No.
Okay. And when you take Old Highway 6, if the first blacktop, that takes you right into downtown where all the business is done, right?
It takes you to the south end of Brooklyn. You'd have to turn and go into town, but
when you turn to go into town, you go over a little bridge.
Mm-hmm.
And yes. Downtown's right there, right?
That's right.
That's where the grocery store is, right?
That's right.
That's where the gas stations are, right?
Yes.
That's where anything of commerce that you would do is, right?
That's right.
Is that where the trailer park is, too?
Yes.
When you come in 385th Street, that's the northern edge of town, right?
Midway, yeah.
That's more of the residential area, right?
Yes.
And did Mr. Bahena tell you that he would go into Brooklyn on the residential side of town?
I don't remember if he said that specifically. I know he told me that he would go, he had friends to visit, or he would go into town occasionally.
On the 20th, as part of your investigation into this case, you also were just gathering information in general, right?
I'm sorry?
On the 20th, part of your job was just gathering as much information as you could, right?
On what date?
The 20th of July.
Yes.
And part of that gathering of information was interviewing Dalton Jack?
Oh, on July 20th, yes, yes.
And was your interview the first real interview that Mr. Jack had to undergo?
I believe he talked to Deputy Simpson the night before.
Okay. But as far as an in-depth type interview, a true interview, not just a fact-gathering interview that Deputy Simpson did, yours was the first one?
Mine was the very next one, yes.
Okay. Now, do you recall the recitation of activities, what Mr. Jack said to you about his activities?
Objection, hearsay.
Can you read the question back, please?
Now, do you recall the recitation of activities, what Mr. Jack said to you about his activity?
Sustained.
As part of collecting information and to further your investigation, you took statements from Mr. Jack, correct?
Yes.
And that was to further your investigation, Deputy Kivi, right? Right?
Yes.
And the statements you took from Mr. Jack were meant to guide you in your next step in the investigation, correct?
Yes.
And did Mr. Jack give you statements that helped guide you in your investigation?
Yes.
What was the purpose in investigating or talking to Mr. Jack?
To gain more information on Mollie Tibbetts, her habits, basically start building what we call a victimology.
What is a victimology?
Like just a background personal history of a victim, habits, preferences, personal characteristics, things of that nature.
Okay. He told you that the night that Mollie was abducted, the 18th, that he was living the hotel life, right?
Yes.
Objection, hearsay.
Overruled. Go ahead.
He told you he was hanging with friends that night, right?
I don't know if he told me he was hanging with friends. He told me he was at the hotel. He was in Dubuque during that time.
He told you that the next day, the 19th, he was working on the bridge in Dubuque, right?
He was working, yes.
He worked till noon.
Yes.
And they got rained out, right?
Yes.
So he went back to the hotel and he took a nap, right?
Yes.
And that he woke up to a friend calling, asking about where Mollie's whereabouts were, right?
Yes.
Okay. Do you recall saying to Mr. Jack that every little detail that he could give you was important?
Sounds like something I would say, yes.
And why is every little detail at that point important?
Because we don't know what's important and what's not at that time. It's pretty early.
You asked Mr. Jack to tell you Mollie's run routes. You recall that?
Yes.
And he told you very specifically that if Mollie runs 3 miles, that she would start at the school, run down by the Jasper Construction Shop, over by Manette's, and then back again, right?
I don't remember Manette's. I remember him telling me that it was possible that she could run north on the gravel, 170th Street, that runs from near that West Des Moines residence north. She would run through town. One of the routes could take her by Jasper Construction, and then possibly out 385th. I don't think Manette's was ever mentioned.
But he had recollection, clear recollection of her run routes, right?
Yes.
And it was Mr. Jack on the 20th of July, 2018, who told you her run routes. That's clear.
Yes.
And you asked Mr. Jack about the possibility of Mollie maybe having another guy, right?
Yes.
And that's just a routine question in any missing person's
case. We had
case.
Nothing to make us believe that, no.
Do you recall Mr. Jack telling you toward the end of the interview that if it means it helps, he would answer any question, no matter how uncomfortable?
I don't remember him saying that, but it's certainly possible.
Okay. toward the end of the interview, Mr. Jack mentioned some rumor he heard about some girl in an accident down by Pekin. Do you recall that?
Yes.
Did you ever investigate that rumor?
I didn't. I don't. I think it was passed on into the our little command post, but I don't remember doing anything with that personally.
And for the record, he told you that he had heard a rumor that some girl and an unknown male had been in a car accident down by the small town of Pekin.
Yes.
And that a third party male had come upon the accident, and the female had injuries, right?
That sounds familiar, yes.
And the female looked at the third party male and said, "I don't know who the other male is with me. Get me out of here."
Objection.
I don't recall that.
Overruled.
Correct?
I don't remember the exact words. I remember asking him, trying to be polite, I remember asking him what exactly how that matched up with what we were doing. What he was telling me just didn't really seem, I wasn't making the connection. If I remember correctly, he said he heard a rumor that like a friend of a friend had been in an accident in some town 60 miles south of here. She had been picked up by some guy she didn't know, and it kind of ended there, as I remember.
Okay. Just kind of an albatross of a rumor.
Yeah, there was another piece of information that added to the stack, I guess.
Yeah, that's true. You authored some search warrants in this case, right?
Yes.
What were those search warrants for?
Oh, I see. I wrote a search warrant for, I'll probably miss some, Google location. I wrote a search warrant for, I think, Mr. Rivera's trailer, his DNA. There was a Nissan Altima involved. I don't know, I think I did 8 or 9. I don't remember exactly all of them.
Did you do a consent search of the Jack residence?
Yes.
Did you notice any firearms?
No. I don't remember seeing any.
You notice any knives?
No, I don't remember.
Okay.
Nothing that stuck out. I mean, I got knives in my house, too.
Were you involved in the investigation of an individual named Andrew Day?
No.
Were you involved in the investigation of a man named Michael Davis?
No.
Were you involved in the investigation of a man named Brandon Roller?
No.
I'm going to butcher this name, but maybe you can help me. He's local.
Yeah.
Were you involved in the investigation of a man named Tim Tometich?
I think it's Tometich.
Tometich?
I think. I'm familiar with that. I didn't follow up on that.
Are you?
It was followed up on. I didn't personally do it.
Are you aware that these are all individuals who were investigated in connection with the disappearance of Mollie Tibbetts?
Yes.
Were you involved in the investigation of any of the employees of Blattner Energy?
Yes.
And just so the jury knows, Blattner Energy was the company erecting windmills in the Poweshiek County area.
Yes.
And what did that investigation entail?
Blattner Energy at the time had what I guess I would call a big camp. Kind of near the interchange of Highway 63 and Interstate 80. That's kind of their operations center. They set up kind of semi-temporarily, but they were there forever. So they had workers coming in from all over the state and all over the region. So as part of our canvassing efforts, we went there, I think twice, and interviewed as many of those employees as we could, or at least identified them.
And the employees of Menash, there were several of those that were investigated as well?
I think we did a canvas at the Menash headquarters in Brooklyn. I don't know if anybody was specifically investigated.
How about Brandon Roller?
I know the name, but I didn't personally follow up on that.
But you were aware that he was someone who was investigated?
Yeah, the name's familiar to me. For more than this, yeah.
A local sex offender?
I believe so.
And that's why he was investigated?
I assume so.
a Curtis and Keaton Laver?
Yes.
They were also investigated?
Yes.
And why were they investigated?
Let's see, I think we, Agent Valletta and I talked to them the first day. And I don't know if that came in as a tip. I think we seized a computer from them that was searched, and we interviewed the younger of the Laver, like the son. He was eventually cleared.
Speaking of computers, at the Jack home, when you went there, Mollie had a computer?
Yes.
Was that searched?
Yes, I believe so.
By whom?
I think it was the FBI.
Would it be, in your training, education, and experience, basic investigative techniques to get all the information off that computer to see her activities in the days leading up to her disappearance?
Yes.
And if it wasn't, can you think of any reason why not?
I don't know if it was, I guess I don't know. I don't know what was done with the computer exactly. I know it was in my possession at one point. I turned it over to the FBI, and I didn't have anything to do with the computer after that.
If it were your investigation that you were leading, what would you have done with that computer? Would you have had it examined?
Yes.
Forensically?
Yes.
That's all I have.
State have any redirect?
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
Deputy Kivi, did you, or were you aware of an interview with the defendant that took place subsequent to your encounter with him on August 16th?
Yes.
And when did that interview take place?
It was on August 20th.
And how was the defendant encountered on August 20th, 2018?
We went to his place of employment at Yerba Farms to do a, I guess you'd call it a focused canvas, to gain a little more information about him and the car and who else might be associated with him in the car. At the end of that canvas, he was taken to the sheriff's office for an interview.
Did you personally go to Yerba Farms on August 20th?
I did.
Were there other law enforcement agents that went with you?
Yes.
You know how many?
I don't know the number. There was, I think, myself, maybe one or two other deputies, DCI agents, Homeland Security, FBI, I think. I couldn't put a number on it. Maybe 12, I don't know.
And were you, or did you have any interaction with the defendant at Yerba Farms?
I identified him as the same gentleman that I saw in Malcolm.
On August 16th?
Yes, I didn't speak with him. I positively identified him.
And were you made aware that an interview with the defendant was taking place?
Yes.
And where were you during that interview?
We had, after Mr. Rivera was transported away, and we left the farm, I don't remember if I went down to the sheriff's office or if I went home. I ended up at home at some point. So at about 9 o'clock that night, our chief deputy, Joel Vanderlees, called me at home and said, hey, they're still down here talking to Mr. Rivera. He has some interesting things to say. You should probably come back here. So I did.
Do you know what time you arrived at the sheriff's office?
It was probably 10.
And when did you leave the sheriff's office then, after you first arrived?
Probably about 4:30 in the morning.
Was that on August 21st?
Yes.
Where did you go once you left the sheriff's office?
We ultimately ended up at a field drive into a cornfield about 400 to 500 feet west of 2478 460th Avenue.
Was anything found at that location?
Yes.
What?
After a search of the cornfield, we found human remains that appeared to be deliberately covered by corn stalks in a cornfield. And those remains were eventually positively identified as Mollie Tibbetts.
Deputy Kivi, I'd like to show you Exhibit 2 again.
Okay.
You see an arrow with an address marked on the image?
Yes.
Does that accurately portray where the body was found?
I believe so.
And I'm going to move the cursor to the location. Can you tell me if that's an accurate spot where the body was found?
So the arrow represents the address?
The cursor. You see the little red
yeah.
dot?
Yeah, that's probably about right. I can't see the actual gravel road marker, but that's pretty close.
I'd like to move to Exhibit 24.
Okay.
Are you familiar with this map?
Yes.
And can you describe what it is, please?
It looks like basically the southern half of Poweshiek County.
Are there markings on that image?
Yes.
And can you tell me the significance of the markings?
The little red pin marker looks like it represents 2478 460th Avenue, which looks like it's that yellow line, that horizontal yellow line. And the body location arrow shows about where the, actually the little red cursor shows about where the body would have been found.
The road that runs north and south directly to the red pin, do you see that?
Yes.
What road is that?
The Poweshiek, Iowa Road.
Is that the county line?
Yes.
Mr. Claver, let me just, for clarification purposes, just inquire. You had referenced Exhibit 24, and we're looking at Exhibit 3. Can you clarify that?
Yes, Your Honor. I had misspoken. I meant Exhibit 3,
okay.
Which is what's pulled up on the screen.
And that clarifies it. Thank you.
Deputy Kivi, when you left the sheriff's office, did you drive to the cornfield at 2478 460th Avenue?
Yes.
Was anyone else in the vehicle with you?
Yes.
Who was that?
I was driving. Officer Pamela Romero from the Iowa City Police Department was in the front seat. Mr. Rivera was in the back seat behind me, and Agent Potratz from the FBI was in the back seat with Mr. Rivera.
Was it dark at that time?
Yes.
Do you recall the approximate time you arrived at the cornfield?
It was 5 or a little after 5 a.m.
Did any other law enforcement officers travel to the cornfield off of 460th Avenue?
Yes.
Do you know who that was?
Sheriff Kriegel, Agent Valletta, Chief Deputy Vanderleest, and Sergeant Jeff Fink from the Iowa City Police Department.
Were you the first officer to discover the body?
No.
Do you know who was?
I believe Agent Potratz was.
From the time the defendant was transported to the sheriff's office on August 20th, 2018, to the time that the body was discovered on August 21st, 2018, were you aware of any other individuals that law enforcement interviewed during that time span? No. Other than the defendant?
No.
Were you aware of any admissions that the defendant made when he was at the cornfield off of 460th Avenue?
Yes.
You were asked on cross-examination about several names that you encountered during the investigation. Do you recall that?
Yes.
Specifically, you were asked about Wayne Chaney.
Yes.
Was any physical evidence associated with Mollie Tibbetts' disappearance or death associated with Wayne Chaney?
No.
And what about Mr. Pesca?
No.
In your investigation concerning Mollie Tibbetts' death involved the investigation of several people, is that right?
Yes.
And among the people brought up by Mr. Freeze during his cross-examination, did you discover any evidence associating them with Mollie Tibbetts' death or disappearance?
No.
Did you see any vehicle in the video, surveillance video, around the time and date that Mollie Tibbetts disappeared other than the defendant's vehicle?
I didn't.
I'm sorry, did I hear the answer?
I did not. I did not see any other vehicle.
Nothing further, Your Honor.
Does the defense have any recross?
Did you ever find a murder weapon?
No.
And the body being found at 2478 460th, Mr. Pexa lived at 2410 460th, right?
Right.
After you found the body, did you think maybe to go knock on Mr. Pexa's door and follow up?
No.
That's all I have.
Mr. Claver, anything else to this witness?
No, Your Honor.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Kivi. You may step down and you're excused.